subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.
Good evening, welcome to South Asia Newsline. I'm Yeshi Chansom. Here are the top stories we are tracking for you on Thursday, the 18th of November. India's Punjab State Chief Minister visits Sikh Shrine in Pakistan as Kartarpur Corridor reopens. Pakistan Taliban violators of religious freedom, says US Secretary of State Antony Blinken. Nepal launches e-passport service replacing machine-readable ones. And now for all the details. Chief Minister of India's Northern Punjab State, Charanjit Singh Channi, along with a delegation on Thursday, visited a revered Sikh shrine in Pakistan via the Kartarpur corridor, a day after the cross-border route reopened. The visa-free pilgrim corridor was closed in March 2020 owing to COVID-19 pandemic.
Chief Minister of India's Northern Punjab State, Charanjit Singh Channi, along with a delegation of politicians on Thursday, visited the revered Sikh site of Gurdwara Kartarpur Sahib in Pakistan via the Kartarpur corridor on the second day of the reopening of the route. The nearly 3-mile-long pilgrim corridor made in 2019 by the joint efforts of India and Pakistan links religiously historical town of Dera Baba Nanak in India's Punjab to Gurdwara Kartarpur Sahib, the final resting place of Sikhism's founder Guru Nanak Dev in Pakistan. The corridor was closed in March 2020 due to COVID-19 outbreak.
ਕਿ ਜੋ ਸਾਡੀਆਂ ਅਰਦਾਸਾਂ ਸੀਗੀਆਂ ਉਹ ਪੂਰੀਆਂ ਹੋਈਆਂ, ਲਾਂਘਾ ਦੁਬਾਰੇ ਤੋਂ ਖੁੱਲ੍ਹਿਆ, ਇਹਦੇ ਲਈ ਮੈਂ ਪ੍ਰਧਾਨ ਮੰਤਰੀ ਜੀ ਦਾ ਅਤੇ ਹੋਮ ਮਿਨਿਸਟਰ ਸਾਹਿਬ ਦਾ ਵੀ ਧੰਨਵਾਦ ਕਰਦਾ ਕਿ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੇ ਪੰਜਾਬ ਸਰਕਾਰ ਦੀ ਡਿਮਾਂਡ 'ਤੇ ਇਹ ਪੂਰੀ ਕੀਤੀ ਹੈ ਅਤੇ ਸਿੱਖ ਸੰਗਤਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਫਿਰ ਤੋਂ ਮੌਕਾ ਮਿਲਿਆ।
A border crossing pact between India and Pakistan allows visa-free access to Indian pilgrims to visit the holy site. The development comes ahead of the 552nd birth anniversary of Guru Nanak Dev on November 19.
Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi on Thursday urged all democratic nations to work together to ensure cryptocurrencies do not end up in wrong hands, cautioning that it can spoil the youth. Speaking at the Sydney Dialogue, a forum focused on emerging critical and cyber technologies, PM Modi also highlighted the leaps in India's digital revolution.
Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi on Thursday urged cooperation between the world's democracies to ensure cryptocurrencies like Bitcoin do not end up in the wrong hands, delivering the comments while his government drew up new rules for digital currencies. In his speech delivered virtually to the Sydney Dialogue, a forum focused on emerging critical and cyber technologies, PM Modi also highlighted the leaps in India's digital revolution and said it was taking care of individual rights. Authorities in India and elsewhere have flagged the dangers of cryptocurrencies being used by terrorist groups and organized crime and the destabilizing risk they pose to national economies. PM Modi also sounded a note of caution regarding digital currencies.
Take cryptocurrency or Bitcoin, for example. It is important that all democratic nations work together on this and ensure it does not end up in wrong hands, which can spoil our youth.
Bitcoin, the world's biggest cryptocurrency, is hovering around the $60,000 level, having more than doubled its value since the start of this year. Indian officials currently drafting regulations are likely to propose a ban on all transactions and payments in cryptocurrencies while letting investors hold them as assets like gold, bonds and stocks, the Economic Times newspaper reported on Wednesday.
Moving on, The United States has redesignated Pakistan as a country of particular concern for violating religious freedom and also rebranded the Afghan Taliban as an entity of particular concern. Pakistan has long been blamed of being tolerant towards rights abuses and discrimination against religious minorities and over its draconian laws that are often misused against them.
U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken on Wednesday redesignated Pakistan as a country of particular concern, along with 9 other countries, for violating religious freedom, and also rebranded the Afghan Taliban as an entity of particular concern, as it is yet to prove it respects the rights of minorities, women and children. In a statement issued by his office, Blinken said, "In far too many places around the world, we continue to see governments harass, threaten, jail and kill individuals simply for seeking to live their lives in accordance with their beliefs. We will continue to press all governments to remedy shortcomings in their laws and practices." Pakistan has long been blamed by human rights defenders of tolerating cases of forced conversion to Islam after abduction and forced marriages of girls from minority Hindu and Christian faiths. They accuse blasphemy laws are often misused in Pakistan to persecute minorities to settle personal rivalries. In 2020, there reportedly were 30 Christians, including 7 on death row, jailed in Pakistan on charges of blasphemy.
The UN envoy to Afghanistan, Deborah Lyons, on Wednesday delivered a bleak assessment of the situation following the Taliban takeover in Afghanistan, saying that an affiliate of the Islamic State group has grown and now appears present in nearly all 34 provinces. The UN envoy to Afghanistan, Deborah Lyons, told the UN Security Council on Wednesday that the Taliban's response to ISKP, Islamic State Khorasan Province expansion, appears to rely heavily on extrajudicial detentions and killings of suspected ISKP fighters. Lyons delivered a bleak assessment of the situation following the Taliban takeover in Afghanistan, saying that an affiliate of the Islamic State group has grown and now appears present in nearly all 34 provinces. The Taliban, she said, has been unable to stem ISKP's growth.
Another major negative development has been the Taliban's inability to stem the expansion of the Islamic State in Iraq and the Levant Khorasan province. Once limited to a few provinces and Kabul, ISILKP now seems to be present in nearly all provinces and increasingly active. The number of attacks has increased significantly from last year to this year.
U.S. senior diplomat Jeffrey Delrentes said that despite the council making it clear to the Taliban that it was in their own interest to peacefully pursue a political settlement to the conflict instead of a battlefield victory, the group chose the latter path, and we are now seeing the terrible consequences of this choice unfold before our eyes. Deborah Lyons warned anew of a humanitarian catastrophe as winter looms due to a failing economy and drought. She implored the international community to find ways to fund the salaries of healthcare workers, teachers and humanitarian workers, saying humanitarian aid is insufficient. While the Taliban is making genuine efforts to present itself as a government since seizing Kabul in August, after a 20-year war with the United States, they continue excluding representatives of other sectors of society and curtailing the rights of women and girls.
Moving on to news from Bangladesh. Bangladesh this week began administering COVID-19 vaccines to slum dwellers in capital Dhaka. Thousands of dwellers took their first shots of the COVID-19 vaccine at Dhaka's mega Korail slum that began from Tuesday. A huge number of residents lined up at the vaccination centers to take the jab. Slum dwellers rejoiced and hailed the arrangement. Bangladesh Health Minister Zahid Malik has said once the majority of Bangladeshis are vaccinated, the country will likely roll out booster shots. Bangladesh launched the vaccine rollout in January. However, it had to suspend the operation in April after India halted export due to a supply crunch. The vaccination drive resumed in June with China donated Sinopharm vaccines. Millions of low-income and extremely poor people are living in thousands of slums across Bangladesh, one of the world's most densely populated countries with over 166 million people. The South Asian nation has registered 27,934 deaths from the virus. It has also recorded more than 1.57 million cases and nearly 1.54 million recoveries. Nearly 52 million people have been vaccinated with the first dose, while more than 33 million have received a second dose. In news from Nepal, in a significant development, Nepal for the first time rolled out a new generation electronic passport. Nepal's Foreign Minister Narayan Khadka handed over the nation's first e-passport to 102-year-old Nepali historian Satya Mohan Joshi at a special ceremony in capital Kathmandu. Officials say it will boost the rankings of credibility of Nepal's passports as it is more secure and made according to global standards.
For the very first time, the Department of Passports Nepal issued an e-passport for citizens on Wednesday. Nepal's Foreign Minister Narayan Khadka launched the e-passport personalization facility at the department and handed over the nation's first e-passport to 102-year-old Nepali historian Satya Mohan Joshi at the special ceremony in Kathmandu. Government officials claim that the e-passport has more security and safety measures than the machine-readable passports that were issued earlier.
सुरक्षाका सबै फिचरहरू यसमा राखिएका छन् जति पनि हामीले पहिला हस्तलिखित या मेसिन रिडेबल पासपोर्ट जारी गर्दाखेरि चाहिने डकुमेन्ट प्लस अन्य डकुमेन्टहरू पनि एउटा चिप्सको मार्फत बायोग्राफिक प्रोफाइलहरू त्यसमा राखेर र डाटा पेजमा पोलि कार्बनडेटबाट त्यो प्रिन्ट भएर आउने भएकाले यो अन्तर्राष्ट्रिय स्तरको गुणस्तरीय सुरक्षित राहदानी हो.
The passport department has also changed shades of the passport, turning to chocolate brown, which was earlier green. The front page of all passport booklets is specified to bear a hot foil stamp of the National Coat of Arms. With the issuance of this new passport, the department said it will be more secure and hassle-free for travellers and boost the rankings of credibility of Nepal's passports. The e-passport will be fully functional by January 2022.
The sky in India's northern Varanasi city is filled with colours as scores of people are enjoying rides during an ongoing hot air balloon festival. The event has been organized to boost tourism as part of the Dev Deepavali festival, which witnesses grand celebrations in the ancient city every year.
A three-day-long hot air balloon festival, which kicked off on Wednesday in India's northern Varanasi city in a bid to boost tourism, is attracting scores of visitors. The first-of-its-kind event has been organized on the bank of Ganges River as part of Dev Deepavali festival, which is celebrated every year in the holy city to celebrate the victory of Hindu Lord Shiva over the demon Tripurasur. Soaring high above the blue sky, visitors were seen enjoying the hot air balloon rides at the height of 1,000 feet to get a stunning view of Varanasi and the holy Ganges River.
वाराणसी में ऐसा पहली बार हो रहा है तो हम लोग भी बहुत दूर दूर से आए हैं यहाँ पे इसका एंजॉय करने के लिए.
यहाँ पे 11 बलून्स हैं बट आई थिंक मोर होना चाहिए क्योंकि यहाँ पे लाइक पॉपुलेशन बहुत ज़्यादा है.
The takeoff and landing of the hot air balloons were being taken care of and flown under the supervision of air traffic control with 8 pilots to operate the balloon. The festival will conclude on Friday.
Well, that's all we have for you from South Asia this evening. Now our viewers can watch the show on southasianewsline.com. You can also visit us on facebook.com/asianewsline and follow us on Twitter at @asianewsline. That's all in tonight's edition. We will see you same time tomorrow. Good night.
Tag TV brings you daily news bulletin from India. Breaking news and views from India.